Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us for this Chaplaincy Innovation Lab Transforming Chaplaincy webinar on supporting staff and staff care through ritual. This is something that actually came up fairly early on in the coronavirus crisis, but of course it takes a little time to get anything together and everybody is kind of flat to the boards these days. So we're happy to do this now, and we know that this is something that can be put into use right away, which is something that we always value. Like I mentioned, the Chaplaincy Innovation Lab is co-sponsoring this with Transforming Chaplaincy. We're very happy to have the leadership of Transforming Chaplaincy on this webinar. So let me just say one more time, welcome, and I will turn it over to Shelley, who will introduce our panelists, and then we'll get going. Shelley.
Good afternoon. Thank you all for joining us. I'm really excited to be sharing with these panelists the information about use of rituals for staff support during COVID-19. I am one of the Transforming Chaplaincy Fellow graduates. My name is Shelley Varner Fettes, and I am a staff chaplain and senior chaplain researcher at IU Health in Indianapolis. I have one of my colleagues joining me today, Josh Coolman, who is a staff chaplain at Riley Children's Hospital at IU Health in Indianapolis. We also have Paul Galchutt from Fairview, Minnesota, joining us. And we hope to have Cathy Chang joining us from Ascension. And additionally, we have Joanna joining us from the Netherlands. We are excited about this webinar and hearing about the various rituals from each of these presenters. So with no further ado, I will hand it over to Paul to get us started. Paul, I'm not able to hear you. Michael, are you able to help us with Paul's sound?
Cool, thanks.
Thank you so much. And if you'll advance quickly, Michael, and show us each of our presenters on the slides. They each have a bio on the slides to move us through. And then we'll get to Paul's slides. If you'll move forward several more. Thank you.
Michael, I appreciate that. A built-in moment of silence to build the suspense for our ritual webinar. So yeah, I get to kick this off by talking about something that we have launched at our place up in Minnesota. If you go to the next slide, please. I'm glad that we'll be talking about ritual, but here's one that I like that I read a few years back from Bob Keegan and Lisa Leahy, folks out of the Harvard Graduate School of Education. I thought that was kind of cool that folks that are not necessarily quote religious are writing about how important ritual is. So you can see that definition. And I do think this ritual prayer wall that we'll talk about is something that allows this to happen. So next slide, please. So what where this idea came about was I'm amazed at how much, I guess I'm pleased is probably the better word, at how much people use the virtual prayer or the actual prayer walls in the chapel spaces that we have within the hospitals. So the wondering became, would staff use something similar if it was virtual? And then if so, what could we use to promise that it would be anonymous and then try to adhere to as much confidentiality as possible? And thankfully, having this research role, I've been introduced to using some data capturing, data collection tools, one of them being RedCap, and you can see their logo. Another one is Qualtrics. There are others out there. But what's kind of cool is that if you have access to these tools or if somebody in your institution does, you can build an anonymous link. There is absolutely pretty much no way for me to trace to anybody. And then you can also, in as much as it's possible, promise confidentiality. I mentioned that because some people have offered their names and some revealing details, but it's a very small group who actually see it. Next slide, please. So this is the actual text that a coworker within mHealth Fairview, my institution, will encounter. And you can kind of, I'm not gonna read it word for word, but it has that invitation, needs, hopes, concerns, and then it tries to also indicate, again, this is anonymous, and in as much as it's possible, we will offer confidentiality. Next slide, please. So when folks do enter into that portal, the next piece they see is the actual kind of survey, and then they have this invitation, and they can either click, I'd like you to offer it as a meditation or as a prayer. And then they have a text box, a pretty large one that they can enter that into. And then after they submit that, they'll get this kind of parting message that is sort of a thank you, seeks to be affirming and uphold the really important work that they're doing. And then at the bottom of ours, there's this that redirects them back into being able to access the resources within our institution. There is another healthcare system in the Twin Cities that has also now launched a prayer wall, and they've on the front where they invite people to write their prayer concerns is a place where you can actually click, you can contact a chaplain. And that's something we played with and wondered about and are still considering, but of course staffing and all those kinds of matters are a big issue. Next slide, please. So thankfully, so that's just not me that's praying or attending to these with meditation. I have a group of colleagues that have volunteered. So Monday through Friday, after a 24-hour cycle, I send them the requests, and then I myself will handle Saturday and Sunday. So I didn't solicit this. These are folks who stepped forward and wanted to do this. Next slide, please. So it does have a digital presence. We communicate online twice a week. We have it go out to our healthcare system so that, you know, the thousands of employees. And then there's also a link within another separate website for supporting coworkers that has access to this virtual prayer wall. And then there's just the good old school. We put up some flyers around the chapels and then the chaplain office doors. And then we thought about business cards, but trying to minimize the contagion concern for that. Next slide, please. So this is my dog, Lily. She's always trying to get my attention. And so we also are trying to seek the attention of people. We find that when people are reminded that the virtual prayer wall exists, you know, the numbers of requests go up. So whatever seems to get our attention. And then in a conversation with George Fichet, he also offered a nice wondering, depending upon where this might be available, given the intensity or a hotspot kind of place, the belief is perhaps that this usage of this virtual prayer wall would actually increase. In case you're interested, how many people want meditations versus prayers? As you can see, it's about 10%. And then these numbers that I have here, they've remained true since I've submitted them. So it's about 7 per day. Next slide, please. So if this gives you a sample, for time reasons, of course, I'm not gonna read all of them, but I think this gives a nice, if you wanted to ask me today, what might be the themes were we to do research, which we're hoping to do on these, what are we hearing? And it's some pretty soulful stuff. I didn't put in some of the heavier ones that are in here, and but it's a place for people in some senses to offer an individual expressive writing kind of moment. So the thing that we want to assure people is that that level of trust, that we are adhering to that confidentiality and that we are attending to that request, hope, or need. That's what I have. Thanks for the opportunity to talk about this. And if you saw my email and these slides, I'd love to talk to you more about it.
Thank you very much, Paul. We appreciate you sharing the ritual you've been using with staff at your facility. There will be a time at the end. We've tried to save about 10 minutes for questions and answers, and our questions and answers will go to all panelists at that time. So I encourage you to write yourself a note if you have a question for Paul and hold it until we get to the end. Next with us is Cathy Chang, and she'll be talking about on-demand spiritual care. Cathy, we're really glad that you could join us today.
Thanks, I'm glad to do this. And what we've done at Ascension is, this is a little bit less of a ritualistic piece, but how we can actually spread spiritual care across distances and times and make it a little bit more accessible for our associates during this time. So what we actually originally had was a program using the Virtual Urgent Care Center in Ascension. and it was open to Michigan State troopers who and their dependents who could call in 24/7, 365. And when COVID-19 happened, there clearly was an increased need for associate care, and it's something that we've been focusing on a lot at Ascension, on how we can make sure that both our frontline associates, but also the support staff, who are all incredibly stressed, had a way of reaching chaplains, had multiple ways that they could actually reach chaplains at a time that's convenient for them. And so we fairly naturally thought, you know what, we're just going to throw open this virtual urgent spiritual care section to everybody else who is at Ascension and all of our associates. What we did is, as of I think March 13th, is we created a service key for them to actually access, so that any associate who has that service key can log in and they can connect 24/7 to a chaplain. So it was originally set up, like I said, for Michigan State Troopers, but we decided that it was something we wanted to throw open to everybody. It's a little confusing, I think, sometimes. So I thought what I would do is actually just show you some screenshots of what it looks like, because I think it's hard to conceptualize until you actually see it. So we can go to the next slide, I think. Or can I do it? There it is. So, like I said, this is a program that you can actually connect into through a two-way video link. You can use it through your computer or you can use it through your phone. I would say most of our associates and have all used their phone to do so. So we have a QR code that they can connect to that takes them to the right place. There's a lot of links in terms of associate self-care resources that they can go to. There's a page that we have that's all set up that will also take them to this site as one of the many associate self-care and support services that we're offering. So it's in there with like EAP and a bunch of other pieces. And actually, they could probably just do it if they went there straight. So as long as they have this service key, they can plug themselves in onto the app and register themselves, and they can connect in. So I'll just show you what it kind of looks like. So at the next slide. So this is the consumer landing page. It's probably a little bit small for you to see. But as you can see, this is what there's a section where you can start to register exactly as if you're going to see a doctor, because this is in fact exactly the same place that you would go to if you wanted to have a teledoc visit for urgent care. So what we look like inside is actually a urgent care practice that's completely staffed by chaplains. So as a consumer, you kind of log in, you see this, it's the see a doctor now section. And if you've already logged in before and it registered, you would just go to the regular login page. So if we go to the next slide, this is what you see if you have the service key. There's probably a couple different urgent care practices that are in there. The one that I have for mine, you would see is a smart health because it's tied to my insurance. There's one that's open to everybody. And then there's the one that says Cops Trust Spiritual Care. Like I said, that was originally set up for our Michigan State Troopers. And so in the rush of things, we did not have a chance to rebrand it. But we worked really hard with marketing to make it clear to all associates that they were in the right place if they saw that. So they have a chance, as you can see, it says add a service key. We are hidden until that service key is entered. So all you would see is the urgent care side until you actually enter that service key. And we have actually separate service keys set up for the state troopers versus the associates. So we know which one is which when they're coming in, essentially. When you actually go in, you would click on the practice. And if the next slide sort of shows this. So once you click on that, this is what you see. It looks like a set of providers, but it's all actually chaplains. And there's one chaplain that's currently on right now. It is set up that, you know, one person, we have it staffed at either a single chaplain or two chaplains on at the same time, depending on what the volume is, so that we can be on round the clock. If you were trying to connect at this particular time, there was one chaplain who was on call and you could click on them. So it's the person who's in green. Everybody else is marked as unavailable, so you couldn't connect through. When this connects through, basically what happens is the chaplain receives a page on their cell phone. It comes from the same phone number every time. So it's exactly like carrying a pager. And it comes through so that they know that this is the particular that they've been paged. When the associate has connected through, pretty much what happens at that point is they get put into a little waiting room, just like you would if you were talking to a doctor. And we have a 10-minute window to actually answer. And when they do, we end up having exactly what you would have as a face-to-face encounter, just online. So it actually works remarkably well. And we've had maybe a call every other day on average since we've opened this from associates from Michigan, Tennessee, Wisconsin, Oklahoma. I feel like there are a few others. Wisconsin, I think I mentioned, Louisiana, and I think New York have all called through. So it is covering a really wide breadth. And then I think the last slide that I have, right, so this is the provider page. Our provider page looks really similar. So basically you log in and you can mark yourself as on call or you can mark yourself as available. We have them marking as on call so that they can get a page. And so from the provider end, pretty much what happens is a little thing shows up saying you have someone in your waiting room and you go in and you click start a visit and then we can talk. So what we found is we've had a really wide range of people who have called through too. And in addition to the fact that they've come from a lot of different states, it started to reach associates that I think we hadn't previously been able to reach. We worked with marketing to really expose this everywhere so that it's at the front when people walk in from the employee entrance, it's posted there, it's posted in break rooms, it's posted at Associate Health, it's posted on our AT, you know, specifically to our AT folks, our Ascension Technologies folks, it's posted to our virtual care team and to HR, so that lots of people know to reach out. And so while we first started off getting a lot of calls through that were primarily from nurses, which made a lot of sense because they had a lot of contact with chaplains, but they wouldn't necessarily have a chance to talk during the day to a chaplain. Lately, it started to reach out to people we haven't previously talked to, like volunteer services. We're starting to get calls from them and from finance and from, you know, Ascension Technology, where, you know, it's our IT person who's calling through. And they've all been incredibly stressed as well, is what we've noticed, because they are providing services that they know are really critical, but they're often behind the scenes. So, for instance, our IT folks have had to vastly increase our virtual urgent care provision, just generally. So there was a day where they uploaded, I think, 18,000 doctors onto this website. And they're incredibly stressed because they know if they can't actually get that up, then the overflow is headed to the hospital. So they know that this is really important. They have to be able to get this up so they can support the folks that are in the hospitals who are on the front lines. Otherwise, we can't capture the folks who are before that point. So it's been a really wonderful experience to hear the cross-section of our associates who have wanted to receive care, who have received care from our chaplains. And I'll say the thing that I've enjoyed most is hearing some of the stories out of our chaplains about how much they've loved hearing not just the stories from the nursing staff and being able to connect with one from a totally different state, but also just how deeply, say, the volunteer services staff has felt and they're particularly caring and how much pride they are in being part of this. They haven't been part of this, but also just the worry and the stress of trying to balance what's happening at home with going in. And I think that that's been the thing that's meant the most to us has been the fact that it does have such a wide breadth that we're able to see how dedicated and how much our associates are really feeling during this time. So it's been really great to do. I would never have been able to do this without the help of the chaplains who are staffing this, but also with the Ascension Technologies team that set this up. Clearly, this is well outside of my technical expertise and really, I think, most of our chaplains' expertise. I was pleasantly surprised too at just how much they value the work that we do as chaplains, and that they bumped us, for instance, ahead of those 18,000 doctors to make sure that we could be there for the associates. And I think that that was really amazing. So that's what I have. I guess I can answer questions sort of at the end.
Thank you, Cathy. And we're really grateful that Cathy, who's the Director of On-Demand Spiritual Care at Ascension Health, was able to join us today. And we'll be glad to share some questions with you at the end. Next is Josh Coolman, who's a staff chaplain at Riley Hospital for Children at Indiana University Health. And he's going to talk to us about blessing of the hands for healthcare workers and the way he was able to modify that during this time. Go ahead, Josh.
Thanks, Shelley. So blessing of the hands is something that we do a lot at the hospitals that I've worked at. It's something that we do for nurses during Nurses Week. We do it for staff who have graduated from a special program in honor of what they've done. We also do it when there's a need, when there's stress or anxiety, or a time to acknowledge the care that staff are giving. And most of the time when I've done a blessing of hands, I've done it with oil. That's the way that I was taught, and that's the way that I've done it most of the time that I've been a chaplain. There's a long history of using oil in biblical traditions. It's a symbol of consecrating, commissioning, and it also symbolizes renewal. So I've used oil, and what I usually do is put oil on the palms of someone's hands and say a prayer of blessing over them. Sometimes I've done litanies with that. When we started doing more isolation precautions at the hospital, I knew that actually touching someone's hands probably wouldn't be an ideal thing. And I was thinking, all right, what could I do that would be different, but still convey a blessing and still use a large part of the ritual? And I had seen people doing a blessing with water before, or pouring water over someone's hands. And I thought that would work in the clinical setting because I wouldn't be touching someone's hands and then touching someone else's hands. So on one of the units that I was working on, one day I had a nurse come to me at the very beginning of our kind of changing into more isolation precautions with COVID. And she asked for some staff support because she realized that her nurses were processing all the changes that were taking place. So she reached out, and I offered to do a blessing of hands during their midday rounding or their midday huddle. So after the huddle, I offered a litany of blessing that included the words, blessed are hands that have touched life, blessed are hands that have felt pain, blessed are hands that have shown compassion, blessed are hands that have offered support. And I added the line, blessed are hands that have protected others from infection. And then I invited nurses after that litany was over, if they wanted to come forward. And I had two bowls. One bowl had water and one didn't. And I invited them to put their hands out, and I took water from one bowl and poured it over their hands. And when I did that, I offered the blessing, may your hands be blessed, and may all of those patients, family members, and staff here in this unit and in this hospital be blessed through your care. So that was the change in the ritual, going from blessing someone with oil to blessing someone with water. And on the next slide, I think there's a photo of a waterfall. And I was thinking of the symbolism that water brings. Today was a rainy day here in Indianapolis, and I was thinking about the renewal after the rain passes. The rain comes and it washes and renews. And when I think about all of the hand washing that we're doing right now, we always do hand washing. Hand hygiene is one of the primary ways that chaplains help prevent infection. But everyone here at the hospital has a heightened awareness of hand hygiene right now. And we're washing our hands over and over again. So doing a blessing of hands with water kind of echoes or mirrors that the symbol of washing and renewal that we're doing all the time here in the hospital. So when I think of that ritual, it's still a blessing that invites staff members to come to have a blessing set over them. And it still involves something physical. And I think we're physical beings. It's hard to sometimes take the physical out of our lives. But by doing the blessing with water instead of oil, there wasn't any contact. So I think that was the innovation right now while we're doing precautions. So I'd be happy to answer questions or talk about that in the end.
Thanks very much, Josh. We appreciate you sharing your modification of a ritual with us. And we know that one of the great things about rituals is that we can modify them for our context, for our setting, and certainly as there are changes in our practice as circumstances demand. So we appreciate you sharing that creativity and that modification with us. We're also really grateful to have Joanna with us. Joanna is joining us by audio today. She is going to talk a little bit about ritual in the Netherlands, and we're really grateful to have her with us. She's a researcher and professor in humanist chaplaincy at the University of Humanist Studies in the Netherlands, and she focuses on new secular rituals. And so, Joanna, take it away. We look forward to hearing what you have to share with us about the use of rituals.
Yes, thank you so much. Can you hear me now? Yes, okay, great.
So, yes, we can.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for inviting me. Well, the first thing that I wanted to talk about real quickly is this Dutch guide on end-of-life rituals within the COVID-19 pandemic that we've co-written within the last weeks. The Dutch Professional Associations for Chaplains has asked us to collect all kinds of examples by chaplains from the Netherlands, from all different kind of religious and worldview perspectives, to share their ideas and share their rituals that they have been developing during this pandemic, but sometimes also even before that. And this document, well, unfortunately, is completely in Dutch, so I can't translate it now, but it is a very rich document with a lot of examples what chaplains have been doing within the last weeks in the Netherlands, and I will talk a little bit more about it on the next slide. I first wanted to start, as of course I'm a researcher and I wonder why things happen, I wanted to talk a little bit more about why do we do rituals and why are rituals important, especially during this pandemic and more specifically in the care for staff. And I think one of the most important aspects is that ritual, well, slow down our everyday life. And especially in healthcare settings where everything is very stressful and there is no time and there's a lot of pressure, small rituals can help to kind of reset your mode, bring attention towards your emotions that we normally in our work environment don't so much do. So if a ritual is done in a safe and in a safe space, it can help to, well, also give another perspective on this reality. Yeah? Rituals make use of a lot of symbolic, aesthetic, and also transcendent elements. Rituals connect us with something bigger than ourselves. And what I also learned by studying rituals for so many years is that even though we cannot change what is happening in the world, but ritual gives us the a space to act in a symbolic way, to act in a aesthetic way, to act in a religious way. So, well, but what kind of rituals am I talking about? And on the next slide, I summarized a few of the examples that the chaplains have shared with us so kindly. For instance, they have been conducting farewell rituals in the hospitals and healthcare facilities, where you can also include the staff. So if you gather around the deathbed of a patient, you can also ask staff, if there is time, of course, to join this farewell ritual. And it has been developed in a very well, it's a complex term, especially in ritual, but I will use it anyway because we used it in this guide. They have tried to make a kind of universal farewell ritual that you can conduct even if you have not a lot of time to ask or find a chaplain that is, well, the chaplain that you would normally choose. And, well, they use, for instance, a little bit of silence or a poem, or everybody can share some thoughts. So a very secular way of conducting this farewell, but it's really developed for this crisis situation when you don't have the possibility to choose the ritual that you want to choose. Well, other things that I've come across is this 1 minute of silence after a patient has died. This is for staff, especially, well, nice to be able to do because, well, you, as I already said, you don't have a lot of time to process everything. Some chaplains also suggested to put a physical symbol on the body bag, for instance, a paper flower or a paper heart with a handwritten message for the family. So it's a kind of when a patient dies without their loved ones being around, the staff tries to make a connection and tell the family something about the final moments or something like that, so that there is a connection between the deathbed without the family and the staff that was around. Other things that I've come across is well, creating the space for staff to take a little moment, if it's possible, of course. And also, and I don't know if this is the correct English term, but the honorary edge. I don't know, do you have this in the United States, where people gather around outside of the building or something? This is not so much in hospitals possible, but more in care facilities where people have been living for a longer time. But well, now with the COVID pandemic, people have done this with a certain distance, but still there is debate whether you can do this. Can you stand outside with more than two or three people? Then we also have digital candles and digital memorials as well. And if you go to the next slide, well, what do all these rituals have kind of in common? What kind of elements are, well, coming back in all these different rituals? And again, these are really examples of secular kind of alternative rituals that have been developed during this pandemic to, well, be able to honor a patient or be able to give the staff a moment of well, a kind of ritual space. So the elements that I've come across is really the use of candles or flowers. And in many healthcare facilities, you cannot use actual candles. We know that, but even the electric candles, although the action of lighting an electric candle is absolutely not the same, but they still look nice and give a nice atmosphere. Then the use of silence. I think silence is very important when you are working in an environment when there is, well, there is a lot of noise and there is a lot of there's a lot of going on, and silence can be kind of the reverse of that. So it can give you a moment to reset yourself. Then, of course, the use of prayer or poems, the use of a specific symbol for condolence. Sometimes we see that if the patient is very well known, the chaplain or the staff choose a symbol that's very specific for this one person. And sometimes we see that a hospital or a healthcare facility chooses a symbol that they will use collectively for every patient that has died or something like that. For instance, laid out a flower on the bed where the patient has died and give the flower later to the family, or collect the flowers somewhere in the building where people can kind of have a little memorial space. I think the most important thing with the use of ritual in care settings is to really transform this everyday space, because ritual is really about making special, trying not to to be to you cannot do ritual very quickly, so you should take your time, talk slowly, have a clear beginning and an end. You should plan the moment and have a fixed time and space, so it's clear, especially if you reintroduce these kinds of rituals during a crisis like at this moment. Rituals are really about trying to make an effort and make something special out of it. And I think also the taking of pictures has also been appreciated a lot by family members, especially when they are not able to say goodbye to their loved ones, or they are not able to attend a funeral or something. So at this moment, if it's possible, of course, it's wonderful if there are some pictures to be taken. And to finish my short presentation, I would like to end with a quote by Clifford Geertz, anthropologist, who says, "In a ritual, the world is lived and the world is imagined, fused under the agency of a single set of symbolic forms, turns out to be the same world." And I think this is really, to me, one of the main points why rituals are so important, because we can create a space, we can create action that perhaps do not change the reality that we are in, but they give us the opportunity to do something meaningful. And as you can see at the photograph, for instance, if you need to let go of something, the letting go of a balloon or something in itself can be, as a ritual action, could be very meaningful. So in ritual, the symbolic and the meaningful are very much the same. Thank you so much. Yes.
Thank you very much, Joanna. We appreciate you being with us today. I do see some questions popping up in the chat box here. I do see that the farewell ritual has been professionally translated into English, and I'm counting on Michael to help us have access to that resource on the CIL website following this webinar. I see another question. Which rituals have been developed during this crisis that you believe will be used regularly post-COVID? And which rituals, if any, have opened your eyes to the possibilities of virtual spiritual care? Is there one of our panelists or multiple ones of you that would like to respond to those two questions?
Well, maybe if I can say something about this, I'm always very cautious about saying something about the future as a scientist, as an academic. So I don't know if I can say what will stay, because I really realized this, all of these alternative rituals are really coming out of this crisis context, and the discussion whether you can do a ritual that is kind of universal, if we might even call it that. In a normal situation, this would be not possible, but we see that now under time pressure and, well, within not being able to have all the resources that you need to have a proper ritual, we see all of these alternative rituals developing and coming up. So I found it difficult to say what will stay, but I think this kind of farewell ritual that you can not only use during the pandemic, but also in other crisis situations when patient is dying really quickly and you are not able to have all the resources that you need and you are not able to, well, the family is not on time or something like this. I think this kind of farewell rituals could be very meaningful also after this pandemic. And I really hope that especially in staff care, but more broader, that because of this, we will appreciate and take the time for ritual a little bit more in our work lives and our everyday lives. But, well, this is only something I can hope for. I don't know. Yes.
Thank you, Joanna. I'm going to move to a question now about the on-demand spiritual care line. There have been a couple questions about logistics. Cathy, if you're able to provide some follow-up about the platform that's used and how many chaplains staff the virtual line and what kind of frequency or capacity of use it's had. Can you give us a little bit more?
Yeah, it's actually run by, through a contract with a company called Amwell. That our virtual care team has a contract with. So they run both what's called the virtual provider office and this virtual urgent care side together on this platform run by Amwell. Don't ask me about the inner workings of it because I really don't know how that works. But I can tell you this, that we've been asked whether or not, you know, it would be a good platform to use. And my general experience is that with any health system, they're going to tell you what virtual care platform you're going to use. Because it has to be a HIPAA compliant system. And that means it has to be encrypted on both ends. And that's changed a little bit right now with the telehealth waiver that we've gotten from Health and Human Services, but that's only going to last during COVID. So the answer is you take what you can get. So I'm just really grateful that they gave it to us. The chaplains are staffed on a 12-hour shift. When we started this with our Michigan State Troopers, it was on a 6 to 6, 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. or 6 p.m. to 6 a.m. Central, 7 a.m. to 7 p.m., 7 p.m. to 7 a.m. Central shift. And because the usage was so low, we were able to do it with just one chaplain on at a time. Right now with COVID-19, and because we've opened it to all of our associates, we have onboarded what we call kind of a crisis team of chaplains. It's our regular hospital staff chaplains who are there. They are going to layer on top of the crew that was already doing the staffing for the Michigan State Troopers, so that we have essentially double the staffing. And we are watching the usage so that we can check and see how long, you know, how deep we need the coverage. Like I said, I think right now we're getting, it averages to about a call every other day, but they actually kind of come in chunks. So we'll have several days where there's a chunk of calls and then not as much and then a chunk of calls. Was there another part of that question? Did I get all of them?
I think you got it. You got the platform and who's staffing it. So that's been very helpful. Thank you.
Yeah. Oh, and I guess as far as the long-term piece, we had always meant to actually open this to associates. And certainly now that it's there, after COVID-19 is over, we're not going to take it away, but we'll sort of decrease the staffing down after we're past what we think is the crisis point.
Wonderful. Thank you. So it sounds like this innovation might carry forward and be a new opportunity to connect with staff, people, and associates at your facility. That's very exciting. Paul, the next one's for you. Wondering if you can say a little bit more about how the virtual prayer wall corresponds or works in sync with prayer walls and chapels, whether you have that kind of setup in your facility. And if you can say more about the prayer or meditation that's offered as a part of this virtual prayer wall, if there's some unique aspects to that, or if you can shed a little bit more light on that for us. You're still muted, Paul.
Thanks. Thank you for that. That one's definitely on me. So the other two questions, thanks for the first one about if there's any kind of syncing between the real prayer walls that are in our chapels and what actually happens on the virtual. There isn't any connection at all. In fact, perhaps like many of your institutions, our spaces are not being used that much because of the restrictions that are being put on loved ones being there. It's a good question as to whether staff are still using them, and I venture they are, and I actually wouldn't know the answer to that about how much staff were using that prior to COVID or not, but that'd be something to explore. And the second question, can you repeat it for me, Shelley?
Sure, there was just a question about whether the process you're using to pray for or meditate on these requests would be different than the process you would use if these came in through the chapel.
Yeah, that's also an important question. We don't script that we don't have a one prayer or a particular meditation. It's just that they're offered to colleagues believing and knowing that it would be attended to somehow.
Thank you, Paul. And then I have a question now for Josh. If you can tell us a little bit more about the precautions that you're taking right now when using the water. Someone was asking, you know, do you reuse the water? Are you getting fresh water each time? You know, maybe are you using gloves or do you feel like those are necessary in this situation? What precautions have you taken?
So from the photo, it might look like I was reusing the water. I wasn't. I was just pouring water from one bowl to another, and I was pouring it slowly so that there was no splashing. And then I disposed of the water in the bottom bowl after the ritual was over. I didn't wear gloves. That might be an idea. But those are the precautions that I was taking.
Thank you, Josh. Let's see. I lost my place here with these questions. There's some wonderful ones coming in. I wonder if Joanna would comment on another aspect of ritual that's been lifted up in the field of study, which is connecting individual experience to the context of larger community. Joanna, would you jump in on that one?
Yes, absolutely. Well, first of all, the ritual in itself creates a community if it's conducted collectively. So you can, you know, by especially in tragic life events like life and death situations, mourning rituals, all these kinds of tragic life events, we see that people by attending together a ritual, they feel connected. And on another level, during the ritual, you can connect to another reality or to a transcendent higher power, or you can connect to the past or the future. So ritual can communicate on all kinds of different dimensions. And creating community is one of the most important functions of ritual in society more generally. So we can imagine that during a pandemic where loneliness is very extremely present at the moment, and especially in death and dying situations, that the need for community is even more present and even more important. Yes.
Thank you, Joanna. I appreciate that. There's another chaplain from Ascension who's said that their facility is using a bi-weekly virtual memorial service for associates who have died, and wanted all of us to be aware of that ritual. And let's see, I think we have time for one more question. There's been a couple of questions in the chat box about support for associates or team members who are working virtually, for instance, those who are in hospice, and what types of rituals might be available, particularly using visuals if we're using a virtual platform. I wonder if there's anyone who would like to speak to additional possibilities to use ritual virtually, and particularly with those who aren't working, say, on site in a central location.
I have there's something that we do in my setting. It's a group expressive writing. It existed with a group already, and it's something that people have looked forward to. In fact, they've been asking for it even more now. So that's been an important contribution, and we're all in different places as we do that.
We have something similar where we have virtual support groups that are being held that run twice a day, actually, that are open to anybody who is an associate who wants to call in so they can have a virtual support group. And then in addition, we've been doing a lot more trying to reach out by email. And in that, you know, we've tried to use a variety of different methods of reaching people. So, like, sometimes it's a written reflection, and sometimes it's like a song that you can attach as a way of reflecting, or a piece of artwork with just a little bit of a reflection attached to that, because people connect differently in different spiritual ways. But I think it's hard in a certain way for us to know what's connecting, because those are things that we're putting out to people, and we don't necessarily get the feedback about whether that's whether that's speaking to their heart in any particular way. We hope it is, and so we offer it. But you know, it's like many of our gifts. We give it out there and hope that it's received.
Thank you, Cathy. And in our last couple of minutes, we want to talk about what's upcoming in terms of education opportunities and opportunities to connect. Michael, I wonder if you'll help talk us through a couple of those upcoming opportunities.
Thank you, Shelley, and thank you all for being with us, and all of our presenters. Joanna, I know we had some difficulty at the beginning with the technology, so thank you for hanging in there with us and powering through, as it were. The information is still extremely useful. Let me just remind everyone, if you happen to come in late, we are recording this, so no worry. You will be able to see the entire thing. We'll post it online along with the slideshow. And I believe there was a request for there apparently is an English translation of the Dutch resource or part of it that Joanna was mentioning. So we will certainly get that out there to you as well. I do want to invite you to the future webinars that we're hosting. The Chaplaincy Innovation Lab is hosting a weekly town hall, we call it, which is sort of a recurring webinar every Tuesday at noon Eastern. And it is generally around a theme, and we have a presenter talk about one particular thing. For instance, last week was about empathy and self-empathy for chaplains, but really it's a place for chaplains to just talk to each other and maybe one or two experts about what they're seeing, what they're experiencing, what they need. It's just an open place for chaplains to be as they're going through all of this. But we have a number of other webinars coming up as well. Next week, we're going to have a webinar on how to write an op-ed for chaplains. And you may have noticed that chaplains are getting a lot more news coverage these days, and rightly so. And so we want to help you to be able to contribute in that way as well. We have some future offerings on grief. We're going to get those set up on the website as well. You can find all of these at chaplaincyinnovation.org/webinars. Everything is free. Just get in there and register, and you'll have access to all of that. What am I missing, Shelley? Anything?
Yes, I actually have a final slide with a poem of blessing for all the chaplains that have joined us today. Are you able to get that back on the screen for us?
Sure, let me reshare that screen.
This is a poem that was adapted by one of the chaplains at IU Health, Eric Williams, who gave me permission to share it with you today. Bless to me the gifts of the earth, strength of granite, depth of salt, edge of flint. Bless to me the gifts of water, flow of tide, roll of ocean, roar of sea. Bless to me the gifts of air, speed of wind, swirl of clouds, width of sky. Bless to me the gifts of fire, heat of sun, warmth of summer, tongue of flame. Blessed am I by the source of elements, unspoken name, hidden face, eternal presence. And with that, I send you off with blessings and salutations for the ministry and care that you are providing. Thank you for joining us today.
Thank you all. Have a great afternoon. Bye-bye.